last time I've stated two theorems for you, and there they are. Well, there were only two theorems last time. So the first one was about the structure of the density matrices for bosons and fermions, and in particular for bosons. So let me remind you that the K particle density matrix is what replaces the correlation functions in quantum mechanics. So they are operators instead of functions, but otherwise they are very much the same. And let me remind you that the K particle density matrix of a wave function psi is defined by the following formula. And I'm giving you here the integral kernel, okay? What you do is you leave K variables which you do not integrate, and then you integrate all the other variables, like for a correlation function, except that here, since you work with psi instead of a probability, you can put different variables here and there, and that gives you a kernel. But if you take all the y's equal to all the x's, then you get correlation functions, the usual ones, I mean the classical ones. Then I discussed a little bit the difference between fermions and bosons, which you can already see from the properties of this density matrices. And I explained to you that so the operator norm of gamma k is less than n choose k, so it's of order n to the k at most. And the natural question was whether this is optimal. Okay, I told you that for bosons, it's definitely optimal, because if you put all the particles in the same state U, maybe I have space here to add a little bit. Okay, so if I take psi to be U tensor N, I put all the particles in the state U, then the gamma k of this psi will precisely be the n choose k, and then the rank one projection onto U tensor k. Okay, so the n choose k is definitely optimal as a bound on the operator norm, and it's saturated for both the Einstein condensates, which are functions of this type. The question was whether this is the only way of saturating the bound, and the answer was yes, if you allow me to look at weak limits. But there might be other ways, but if you only look at weak limits, then it's the only way, and that was this quantum definity, which we proved in this version with Fantanam and Nicolas Rougerie, which is the following, that you take any sequence of bosonic operator. It's a very abstract theorem. You don't have to look at a concrete system, right? You take any sequence, you divide by the n choose k, and you assume that it converges weakly to something, which you can always do by compactness. So you assume it converges weakly, then there exists a probability measure P over the unit ball of your Hilbert space, so that this gamma k is an average of the U tensor k's for this P, which is independent of k. So you must have a convex combination of Bose-Einstein condensates. Okay, so this was saying that at the order n to the power k, that's essentially the only thing which can happen. I also mentioned a bound for fermions, that the norm is like essentially n to the k over 2. You remember, I think I forgot to tell you that it's optimal, right? So we have examples of wave functions which give exactly the behavior I told you, but we don't know the optimal constants. So that was the first theorem. And then what I did was to describe the free quantum gases in the thermodynamic limit, because I thought, I mean, if you've never seen them, then it may be hard to follow some more advanced talk. I mean, it's supposed to be very elementary, but still cannot hurt to see it again, or maybe even for the first time. So what is it about? So it's only about the Laplacian. There's nothing, no interaction is. So it's just about looking at the Laplacian and how things behave with respect to the symmetry of these particles. Okay, so it's a little bit a mixture between some algebraic constraints, namely symmetry, anti-symmetry, and just the behavior of the Laplacian. So we take a domain omega, volume one, nice domain. I mean, you can play with the regularity and so on. I'm not going to do that. So you take a domain omega of volume one, and then you scale it to make it larger and larger and occupy, I mean, just cover the whole space. And in this omega, you just put n particles, okay? And you are gonna, you're choosing n in terms of L to make sure that the density of particles, which is n over the volume, is fixed. Okay, so you put as many particles as the volume, and you hope that they will essentially occupy occupy all the space more or less uniformly. And you want to know what's the distribution of the velocities. That's the goal. Okay. So you also fix a temperature, T, which is 1 over beta. And then you look at the corresponding Gibbs state of this problem, which is the operator exponential minus beta h, h being the Hamiltonian. You compute the one particle density matrix. It's much shorter to write with the partial trace, but it's something like that, where in addition you sum over, because gamma is an operator, you remember, it's this definition of mixed states. And then you ask yourself, what's the limit? What is Hn? Hn is the Hamiltonian for the system, which is just the kinetic energy. So the only thing that they are doing is moving, but they don't see each other. Okay, they are independent. Well, independent, not quite, because of symmetry, right? So we have, for instance, fermions, they are independent, but still don't like each other. So they are not that independent, but, okay? So the Hamiltonian is just the sum of the Laplacian over the domain L omega in each variable xj over the space L2 of Rd to the power n, restricted either to anti-symmetric or symmetric functions. And I'm taking the Dirichlet Laplacian. Very good. And then there was a long theorem. And I think I'm going to take some time discussing the theorem again, just because I had some interactions with some of you and many interesting remarks and questions. And I would be happy to get more. So let's take just time to discuss these three gases. I think it's useful. And you will see it's actually not trivial. It's surprising that it is so interesting in some sense. But I mean, the Bose gas, the free Bose gas, is very complicated. So what is happening? So if I look at fermions, namely I restrict this Hamiltonian to anti-symmetric functions, I take only the trace over anti-symmetric functions everywhere, I discard everything else. Then when I look at the one particle density matrix, there's a similar result for the other ones, but when I look at the one particle density operator, it converges to a translation invariant operator, so a Fourier multiplier, which is given by this Fermi-Dirac distribution, 1 over exponential beta k squared minus mu plus 1. Okay? And mu is related to my parameter, so I had fixed beta already. Mu is the missing parameter, namely rho. Okay? So mu is the chemical potential, which is the dual variable to rho in the sense of Legendre transform. So mu is chosen to make sure that I have exactly rho particles per unit volume. Okay, and if you compute how many particles, I mean, if you compute what's the local number of particles for this guy, you will see it's exactly this integral here. You have to add a 1 over 2 pi to the d. And so mu is the unique mu which gives you rho, the rho that you had fixed. Okay, that's the free Fermi gas. I have to tell you that, of course, if you work at zero temperature, which you can do, then the same result is true. But of course, at zero temperature, you have to replace this by the limit when beta goes to infinity. What's the limit? You see, when beta is extremely large, that will depend on the sign of k squared minus mu. So when it's negative, you get 1, and when it's positive, you get 0. So you get 1 k squared less than mu. When t is 0. Okay, so this is how you should interpret this times u, of course. Okay, so that's the zero temperature case. Mu is the square of the Fermi momentum that Marcello had yesterday in his talk. So you see, you get the Fermi sphere, you get the projection over the ball of radius square root mu in Fourier space, and square root mu is called the Fermi momentum. And that's also called the Fermi sphere. Okay, so that's the free Fermi gas. This is what is happening for fermions. the density matrices are all of order 1, the operator norm is of order 1, and they converge to these Fourier multipliers, which represent an infinite gas of fermions. That's the free Fermi gas. For bosons, things are much more complicated and depend really very much on the value of rho. So you have to introduce the following critical density, which depends on the temperature, which is given by the following integral, which is the same as here when mu is 0 and you put a minus instead of a plus. And you see that in dimensions 1 and 2, so there's a, at infinity, no problem. But at 0, this integral is not always convergent. It behaves like 1 over k squared. And so this will be infinite in dimensions 1 and 2 and finite in higher dimensions. And it behaves like t to the d over 2 by scaling. Beta is 1 over t. Huh? Okay, so that's the critical density. And depending on the value of the initial rho, something very different will happen. So if your rho is not too high, so if rho is less than this critical density, then you get the same result as for fermions. So you get an infinite gas, a perfect guy, no problem. Everything is of order 1, nothing special is happening, except that you have a minus 1 instead of a plus 1. And mu has to be chosen so that this holds. Okay, and this mu will be strictly negative always. Huh? Okay. So that's the Bose gas in case the density is not too large or the temperature is not too small. Okay, and now when the density is too large, so here I'm thinking of fixing the temperature and moving the density, but you can fix the density, move the temperature, it's the same. So when the density is large, then there will be a completely different behavior. Namely, you will really get an eigenvalue of order n popping up in your system. I wrote it slightly differently. I think I wrote the volume instead of n last time, but it's the same. Okay, and this eigenvalue of order n is going to be of multiplicity 1. There's just one eigenvalue of order n. No two eigenvalues, just one of order n in this limit, and it's given by rho minus the critical rho divided by rho, and the corresponding eigenfunction is just the first Dirichlet eigenfunction over the big domain. Okay, so that's the guy. So it has suddenly an eigenvalue of order n, and if you would compute gamma 2 and so on, they would all have exactly one eigenvalue of order n to the k, as predicted by this theorem. Okay, and then in the limit you get your thermal cloud, if you like. So that's the thermal cloud. That's the Bose-Einstein condensate here. Okay, which is just the same as for fermions, but with a minus and mu equal to 0, which is the maximum you can go. This only happens in dimension 3 and higher, because in dimension 1 and 2, rho is infinite, so you are never in this second situation if rho is fixed. Okay, so you have to give a meaning to these quotation marks. There are several ways. So for instance, what you can do is to really check that there is only one eigenvalue of order n, so you take gamma 1, you divide it by n, you subtract this thing, and you look at the operator norm. You have to be careful using the right norm, right? And then this goes to 0, okay? What you can also do is to be more in a microscopic setting. So you take an F, you test against gamma 1, you compute, and then let me remind you, maybe, let me remind you that the first Dirichlet eigenfunction is just a rescaled It's just a rescaling of the first Dirichlet eigenfunction over omega, right? With the obvious scaling, okay? And then when you pass to the limit here, you see u1 of 0. That's because you somehow look what's happening here close to 0.
Why Dirichlet at the boundary don't have a condensate? Or why the Dirichlet eigenfunction?
Oh, because I started with the Dirichlet Laplacian.
Oh.
Okay, so you see, and that's very important, that this part here, the thermal cloud, doesn't see the boundary condition. Well, you always get the same. However, the Bose-Einstein condensate depends very much on the shape of omega and even on the boundary condition, because it depends on U1. I would like to insist on something that it's, so this limit here really has two scales. Right? So there are two, not independent, but two different scales in the problem for this Bose gas. And these two terms really don't live at the same scale. And you have to play and always treat the two scales, treat both the two scales. If you work at only one scale, you will miss the details of the other scale. Okay, so this here is a limit at the microscopic scale, where you see the thermal cloud. But then the Bose-Einstein condensate, you only see this, this term here, and there was this picture. So what is the velocity distribution in a momentum space? So that's so here it's essentially Boltzmann, right? And here it's 1 over beta k squared. And then you get a huge delta at 0, at k equals 0, which is this term. So rho minus rho c of t divided by rho times 2 pi to the d delta k equals 0. Okay, so if you work at the microscopic level in momentum space, you see this huge delta. Okay, and I mean, you don't see much of the, oh, I forgot the u. And then you see the value of the corresponding first eigenfunction of the region where you were working. Okay? But so since I got the question, I would like to emphasize. So if you divide by n and do the weak limit, now you try to apply this theorem, what do you get? You get 0, right? Because U1 tends weakly to 0, and so this will disappear weakly if you divide by n. Why? But that's because you're not at the right scale. Right? The Bose-Einstein condensate does not live at the microscopic scale. It lives at the macroscopic scale. So in order to see it, you have to rescale everything. Okay? So be careful. Okay? So that to see the BEC, you have to work at macro scale. So you have to rescale length and everything, which is a unitary operator, so it doesn't, I mean, you can still apply the theorem at the new scale. And now this is just going to be fixed. You will get just a projection of a U1, and then you will even get strong convergence, not weak. Okay? And then the theorem can apply. So this tells you that the weak convergence is very, I mean, that's the weakness of the weak convergence. And it doesn't always tell you something, right? Because if you don't work at the right scale, you may miss something because the eigenfunction goes weakly to 0. Okay? So if you work at the scale, so you rescale everything, then you are in omega. Okay, then the new rescale gamma 1 divided by n will converge even strongly now to rho minus rho c of t divided by rho, and then U1, U1. And that's Bose-Einstein condensate, which takes place at the macroscopic scale. Okay. So the picture is the following. I try to, maybe I do another picture here, okay. Okay, so here you got the curve, so that's t and rho. Here you have the curve, which is like a rho to the 2 over d, and here is the BEC. That's the BEC region. It's the phase diagram of the free Bose gas. Questions? Happy, tired, both.
So at some point you said that it was a theorem that everybody knew.
Oh yes,
but
yes.
No one knew where it was written. So can you?
Yeah, I'm going to give references and So the next step is to give you references and then discuss a little bit. I'm not going to do the proof, right? It would take, maybe even more than 2 hours. It's not so easy. But I will give references and give you a vague hint. Should we do that now? Okay. So that's the end of the recap part of this lecture. So now, references. Did I want to tell you something else? No, I think it's okay. So references. So I think is theorems of that kind are really due to Katz in 71, except that apparently he gave a lecture about it, which was never really published. But there is a later paper with Uhlenbeck where some parts of the lecture are repeated. But many of the later papers refer to Katz, some lectures he gave about this problem. Okay, so I think the first proof that you can find, they are due, so we'll find many proofs about a team with many different combinations of authors, Lewis, Poulet, Van der Berg, also Zagrebnov. Also in the 70s, there are several papers. If you just look for free Bose gas, free bosons, Lewis, Poulet, you will find many. However, many of those works, they would only work in the grand canonical case, which I will define afterwards. Okay, so the canonical case, which is the theorem I've presented, so I found a reference by a guy called Cannon, which is funny, I think it's, but anyway, so Cannon studied the canonical case. I mean, Katz also, but it's hard to say exactly what was in there. And he was not looking at density matrices, so he had a different notion of convergence. I mean, he was looking at wide observables, as one likes to do for bosons. So his result, strictly speaking, does not imply the theorem I wrote. But anyway. And then you, no? Should I mention something else? I don't know. So then there's a beautiful work by Deutscher, Seiringer, and Ingvason. In 2018, you see it's a big jump in years, where they actually study the interacting case. And I think that when looking at the interacting case, they had the same problems that I had when I had to prepare this lecture, that it was hard to find references. So they wrote an appendix about the free Bose guys, where they provide a very nice argument, which is actually a bound, well, I'm not going to be too precise, but which is a bound on the canonical density matrix in terms of the grand canonical one, okay, universal bound, which if you use it, then everything becomes much simpler. Okay, and then the theorem, I think, can easily be proved with your bound. Otherwise, I would not be able to give you a reference for a proof of this theorem before. So I think this theorem was kind of known, but do you know a reference, Andreas? No. Okay. Good. So then I strongly advise to use this method, which is very efficient and elegant. But you have to mix these arguments maybe with older arguments, and then you get the theorem. You can read lots of things in the book by Bratteli Robinson if you are not allergic to operator algebras. The second volume, there's a whole section about Fermi gases, a whole section about the Bose gas, but it's all grand canonical. So let's define the grand canonical model. just from the theorem, you understand immediately that it's much easier to work grand canonically than canonically, which you know if you do statistical mechanics, I guess, but maybe it's not so obvious to you if you are not used to that, just because everything is so easy with mu. You see, if I would have to write these limits in terms of rho, then I have to invert this crazy function, this integral I did not even compute. I mean, I can compute it with some special functions, maybe the zeta function or something. It's not explicit. Okay. So fixing rho, I mean, sounds very natural, but it's actually mathematically not easy. It's much, much easier to fix mu. So the proof goes by rather fixing mu and study the grand canonical limit, and then prove that the canonical problem has the same limit as the grand canonical with the corresponding mu, which can be not so easy sometimes. Anyway, so grand canonical model, we let n vary, or the number of particles becomes random, if you like, fluctuates. I don't know how you want to formulate it. And then we work in Fock space. Don't leave. Don't be afraid. It's going to be fine. You've seen many Fock spaces already. I know it's not fun, but it's not that complicated. So we work in a Fock space, which is just a way of putting all these possibilities together. So what is the Fock space? Well, there are two, because there is the fermionic one and the bosonic one. So it's just the direct sum of all the possibilities of having zero particle. When I have zero particle, I'm going to model this by C. Okay, it's there you go. And then I put the space for one particle, the space for two, the space for three, so on and so forth. So I do the big sum, n larger or equal to 1 of L2. Maybe I put directly omega to the power n, because that's where we... And then either symmetric or anti-symmetric. I want to insist that there's no n factorial. Right? So if I compute the norm of a big psi, this is really the norm of the psi n squared. This n factorial has a long history. Okay, you know, if you work in a classical mechanics, then you don't work in a Hilbert space, but you work in the convex, maybe, let's recall. So in a classical Fock space, how is that called in classical mechanics? Does it have a name?
Grand canonical.
Grand canonical, okay. It's not a space, so.
Grand canonical
phase space. Phase space, okay. So classical case, what's the classical case? There you work in a convex set, right? And that's a collection of positive measures, right? Each measure Pn is a symmetric measure over omega n. And then the sum of the integral of Pn divided by n factorial must be 1, okay? Now you will tell me it doesn't matter whether I put the n factorial or not, because I can always include it in Pn. That's what you will tell me, but I would disagree, because this n factorial plays a big role once you look at entropy. Right? So the entropy will be Pn log Pn, and you put again an n factorial. And if you don't put the n factorial right, then the free energy will not be of the order of the volume. And as soon as you talk about entropy, then it makes a difference whether you put the n factorial like that or whether you include it in P. Okay. Why do you put an n factorial? That's because you are counting things too much, too many times. You have n particles, and you don't want to distinguish when they are like that and when I exchange labels. So I just divide by n factorials, because I have all these simplices. So I'm just integrating over one simplex, if you like. Okay. But in the quantum case, we don't have to do that, because we have already taken into account the symmetry by restricting to the symmetric or anti-symmetric subspace. Okay. So due to the fact that we will take a trace in a very small subspace, the n factorial is already here in a sense. So then I should not put it, it's better. Okay? Good, so on this space there's a number operator. I mean, you can always put it, but then you have to correct the entropy appropriately. So the number operator is just 0 plus n. Okay, so this is giving me the number of particles. And then I have my Hamiltonian, which is just 0 plus hn. There you go. And then I have the state, the Gibbs state, which is just z minus 1 exponential minus beta h in Fock space. So if you like, it is z minus 1, and then there is 1 plus, and then plus e minus beta hn. Okay? So I'm just taking a collection of everything, and what is z? Z is the sum of the traces without an n factorial. Okay, so z is a 1 plus the sum n larger than 1, the trace of e minus beta hn. No n factorial. Okay, so, and I forgot the mu now. Ah, I have to put the mu, because I want to play with mu in order to get the desired density. So I will shift everything with mu, okay, sorry, minus mu n. So here I have an exponential beta mu n, which people in statistical mechanics like to write z to the n. Okay, so that's the Fock space. You see, it's the generating function of the partition functions for our canonical problem. Very good. So why do people use the why is the grand canonical easier? That's because the Fock space, these quantum Fock spaces, they have a very specific algebraic structure, which you don't see here. It looks very innocent. Okay, but these Fock spaces, they actually represent some very specific operator algebras. And this is very useful to do computations. Okay, so many complicated computations become extremely easy if you use the hidden algebra behind this construction. The algebras are the canonical anti-commutation relations and canonical commutation relations, these annihilation creation operators, and so on and so forth. Let me not enter into the details. Okay, so what I want to tell you is there is a very simple algebraic structure, and this structure is a little bit like an exponential. So, I mean, you see that's a little bit like an exponential, sum 1 over n factorial, blah, blah. It's the same in the quantum case. So there is a very specific structure. So the lemma is the following. You can compute z. So this is well defined, if you like. So we have that z. So I'm going back to our problem. So I'm taking a domain omega, I scale it, I look at the Laplacian. And then this is well defined if z is finite. I need z to be finite. When is z finite? Well, we have z finite for all mu in the fermionic case and mu negative, at least, in the bosonic case. Okay? And actually, there's a formula for z, which I'm going to write down, which is the following. It's the product over I of 1 plus or minus exponential minus beta, the eigenvalues, minus mu, to the plus or minus power 1, where the plus are for fermions and the minus for bosons. Okay, so you see that the z is a product of these eigenvalues, and then if you take the log, you will see why it's finite and not finite. Okay, let me tell you that the trace of exponential minus beta, the Dirichlet Laplacian over a domain omega, is always finite if omega has bound as a finite volume. Okay. Due to the Weyl asymptotics, the eigenvalues, they tend to infinity polynomially. So this is enough to be summable when you take an exponential. Okay, so there's a formula for the partition function, exact formula, and there is also a formula for the corresponding gamma 1. Okay, so the grand canonical density matrix of this Gibbs state, okay, which is 1 over exponential beta minus Laplace on the domain L omega minus mu plus and minus 1. Okay, so that's the lemma. So in the grand canonical case, you can compute everything. In the canonical case, you can't. I mean, if you start trying to compute, you will get crazy formulas, and it's not easy, but grand canonical is just explicit law.
Is there a typical reason why you take all the coefficients to be 1 in front of the... I understand that from the mathematical point of view, there is a reason with this algebraic computation that you put 1 in front of each psi n to the square.
Because I have already taken into account...
Not necessarily 1 over factorial n, but say any other coefficient.
Well, in principle, you can do whatever you like, but it's only when you do something nonlinear that you will see the difference. So the entropy, which is a P log P, or trace gamma log gamma, there you will see a difference. It's the only case where you will see the difference. So if you put an n factorial in the quantum case, then the free energy will not be of order n.
It could be also that when you do some computation, when you are projecting on finite dimensions, so on density matrices, there are some things which are easier in this
case. Which are easier, yes. Yeah, I don't know. But
let's say from the my question is, from the physical point of view, what would be the reason to take this specific choice?
Oh, I mean, it's
I have the same question for the grand canonical. I don't have the answer.
In a way, I mean, you can think of this z to the n as a change, if you like. It's just that I am reinterpreting the z to the n as changing the Hamiltonian and then inserting the mu. So if you are going to change something by to the power n, then it's the same as changing mu. So you change the Hamiltonian instead of changing your norm. It's maybe better, I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. Does somebody have a better answer? No. Okay. If you start to, I mean, this lemma is just a computation, okay? But it can be messy if you don't do it the right way. So I'm not going to do the proof, but you can do the proof using the algebraic properties of your Fock space. Andreas?
I mean, it's maybe natural when one thinks of probabilities. It's still the most natural thing, right? To have not to wait. Yeah. Why would one wait?
You have to choose one, okay, it's more natural, but say there is no reason why to choose one specific case.
Why would we weight the probabilities for different particle numbers?
So let me just give you the main property which makes this proof easy. The main property is that the Fock space behaves like an exponential. So if you have a Hilbert space which is a sum of two Hilbert spaces, a direct sum, then the Fock space behaves like the tensor product. That's the main property. It's exactly like an exponential of spaces, a bit. Okay, so I mean that's up to some isometry. Okay. So that's the main property. You have the same in the classical case. I mean, if you take two domains, omega 1, omega 2, and you look at C of omega, then this is really like the tensor product of C of omega 1 and C of omega 2. Because you can look whether, instead of looking whether the particles are in omega, you can look how many are in omega 1 and how many are in omega 2. And you can make the distinction. Okay, and you will find the C of domain omega is omega 1 union omega 2 is essentially C of omega 1 tensor product with C of omega 2. Okay. So there is an exponential structure behind. And why does this make things easier? Well, because our H, which is L2 of omega, is the direct sum of one-dimensional spaces, right? Just the span of the Dirichlet eigenfunctions. And so, and you want to compute a trace, and also, and the operator is the exponential of something which is a sum. Okay, so everything factorizes. Okay, the exponential of a sum of the individual guys is like the product, a tensor product, and you compute a trace, and so the trace just becomes a product. So what I want to tell you is that you have to understand how to manipulate things only in the one-dimensional case. Okay, and what is happening in the one-dimensional case? So let me work now in a one-dimensional case. Okay, so then I have just one eigenfunction UIL and one eigenvalue lambda IL, nothing else. Okay, so I'm working in dimension one. What is happening? Well, what is the Hamiltonian? Well, first, what's the space? Okay, so the Fock space in one dimension for fermions is trivial because I can decide to put zero particle or one particle, but I can never put two, because they have to be in different states, fermions. Okay, so the F A of C has dimension 2. You have to decide whether you put one or a zero or one particle. Okay, and so let's do the fermions here. And the H, what is the H? Where the corresponding H, I don't know how to call it, so H restricted to UIL. So the energy is zero if I put nobody, okay? And the energy is lambda I if I put one guy. So what is exponential minus beta H minus mu? That's the following matrix, one and exponential minus beta lambda IL minus mu. Okay? So when I compute the trace, I get 1 plus that, and that's the 1 plus that. And then I take the product because of the product structure I explained to you. Okay? That was for fermions and for bosons. Okay, so I have only one mode. So what is happening for bosons is that even if it's one-dimensional, the Fock space is infinite-dimensional because I can put as many bosons as I like. So the corresponding H for this just one mode will be a zero. Okay, when I put one boson, I get lambda IL. If I put two, then I have to put them in the same state because I have only one state. And then the energy is two lambda IL, and then I get 3, and so on. Okay, so I get this simple diagonal matrix. And then when I take the exponential, I just get 1, and then exponential minus beta, minus mu n, lambda IL minus mu n, minus mu, and then 2 and so on. And then you see that when I compute the trace in this one mode, Fock space, then I get a geometric series. When I sum it, I get 1 over 1 minus exponential blah blah, which is exactly what's written here. You have 1 minus this guy to the minus 1. Okay? So bosons, you get a geometric series because you can put many bosons in just one state. Fermions, you just have two terms with a plus. And then the computation for the gamma 1 is similar. Okay. And that's why you get this strangely looking at first sight 1 over exponential beta x plus or minus 1. Okay, so one is a geometric series and the other one, no. Okay, so that's how you compute in the grand canonical setting using the algebraic structure. You just reduce everything to a dimension 1 Hilbert space, and then it's just a geometric series. Very good. So now you see that the grand canonical problem is reduced to studying this operator. Let me finish with this before the break. So now you have to understand what is happening to 1 over exponential beta, the Dirichlet Laplacian minus mu plus or minus 1. Okay, so it's just that you have this operator, okay, over a domain of size L, then you enlarge the domain. Okay, so you can very, I mean, it's pretty clear, at least intuitively, that this will converge to the similar guy over the whole space for any fixed mu. Okay, so if I increase the domain, then I will converge to the limit. So you can immediately understand or have the intuition that the theorem is going to be very easy if mu is fixed so that this function is well defined. So mu anything for fermions, and for bosons mu strictly negative, okay, to make sure the denominator does not vanish. Then it's just, I mean, it's just an easy limit.
But in which sense?
Yeah, so let me give you a small exercise. Okay, so take any function continuous which goes to zero at infinity on R. Then I claim that f of the Dirichlet Laplacian apply to the function u converges to f of the Laplacian apply to u in L2 for all u in L2. Okay? And that's exactly the statement which was in the theorem. That was for any function of the Laplacian. And if you try to prove this lemma, recommendation, start with, not with this f, which is crazy, okay, but start with f of x, which is x minus z to the minus 1 with imaginary part of z non-zero, because then you reduce the problem to studying the following easy so what you have to study is the behavior of this solution, okay, when L goes to infinity. Okay, so u is fixed, you truncate u, and then you solve this problem here. Okay, and you have to show that v converges strongly to the unique solution of the same thing in the whole space, namely minus Laplace minus z minus 1 u. Simple exercise. Okay. And once you know it for all z, then by some Stone-Weierstrass, whatever, you get it for all f, and therefore you get it for these functions. Okay, so that's how you prove the theorem in the grand canonical case at fixed mu, and when there's no BEC. Now I have to soon make a break. I'm still looking at the time. Yes. So how do you handle the BEC case? Well, it's not easy, right? But so now imagine I have fixed a row which is above this critical row. Okay. So what is happening for this guy? Okay. If I compute the row that I get at a given mu, okay, so I am picking a mu, and then I compute how many particles I have in average. This is just the trace of this gamma. So this is just, if you like, the sum of 1 over exponential beta lambda I L minus mu minus 1 for bosons. Okay, it's just this sum over there. Okay, what is happening? Okay, you see that even if L is fixed, I can get any row that I like. Okay, it's just that I have to take mu converge to the lambda 1, which is the first that mu will see. Okay, so when I compute this series here, then when mu goes to a lambda 1 L, this is divergent because of the denominator. Okay, so I can always pick a mu which will now depend on L. Okay, so there exists a mu L, so that this is equal to rho. The claim is that this mu L converges to a nice negative mu if rho is below the critical density, and this mu L will go to the first eigenvalue if you are above. Okay, and so the exercise is to prove that mu L behaves like lambda 1 L minus rho minus rho c divided. So now I will maybe get it wrong. Let me check this. Yeah, got it completely wrong. So it's 1 beta L to the d rho minus rho c plus little o of L to the minus. Okay, so that's what you can prove, or what you have to prove. Okay, so let me remind you that this guy goes to 0. Okay, but this guy goes to 0 like 1 over L squared. And so mu has to approach the eigenvalue at speed 1 over L to the d, so as to build a rho which is subcritical. Then what you have to do is to study the limit of the corresponding operator, which obviously will have an eigenvalue of order n, right? Because if you look at the, right, I mean, the largest eigenvalue of gamma 1 will be 1 over exponential beta, and then 1 over L to the d beta rho minus O. So I got it wrong, as you can see. This is in the numerator. No, oh, no, no, it was fine. Minus 1, okay, so that's the largest eigenvalue of gamma 1. And this goes to 0, so this behaves exactly like L to the d rho minus rho c, which is what we want. Okay, so let me summarize now before we make a small break. Maybe I summarize with a picture which I put here. And that's going to be the end of what I wanted to tell you about the free gases, and then we will look at the interacting cases in the next hour. So here I have lambda 1 L. Okay, so if I stay away of lambda 1 L by a step minus 1, there I will build rho less than the critical rho. Okay. If I want to build a subcritical rho, then I have to approach this guy and go below by something of order minus constant over L to the d. Let me remind you that this guy behaves like 1 over L squared. So there is definitely, and then there's the next eigenvalue, which is also 1 over L squared. So clearly there's something is happening when d is 2, because then they behave of the, and that's why dimension 2 is critical in this problem. But if we are in dimension 3, then this distance here is much smaller than that distance, which plays a role in the proof to estimate things. Okay, because there's a kind of a gap. Okay, so in this region, where I work at distance 1 over L to the d of lambda 1, then I can construct subcritical rho and a BEC. So let me mention, let me make some advertisement that tomorrow, Nicolas Rougerie, we look at the case where mu is of order 1 over L squared, okay, which is a little bit before. Okay. So all this region here is kind of close to the transition, right? Because there you are above the transition, here you are before. So when you go to zero slower than L to the D, then you are kind of at the transition, more or less. And Nicolas will explain to you that when you go like 1 over L squared, then you see how the Bose-Einstein condensate forms. Okay, so you explain the formation of the BEC. And this can be understood in terms of Gaussian measures, so infinite dimensional Gaussian measures. Gaussian free field, I don't know how you want to call it. Actually, you will see minus Laplace plus C. So it's a massive Gaussian free field, how you call it, Yukawa?
In what dimension?
Well, actually, in all dimensions, but say D larger than 3, if you like, but there will be... I mean, you are allowed to go like 1 over L squared in one dimension as well. The same will happen. So, on Friday, Nicolas will explain to you what we did in the interacting case. But in the non-interacting case, you see these Gaussian measures. They explain the way that the condensate is forming when you approach the transition. And this corresponds to taking mu's of order 1 over L squared. I don't know if something interesting is happening when you are either on the left here or on the right. You see the Bose gas, even the free Bose gas, no interaction, is very rich. I mean, there are lots of things to do. But after the break, I have to tell you one sentence, and then after the break. So once you've studied the grand canonical, you have to prove that the canonical behaves the same as the grand canonical, which has the mu, which gives the correct rho. This is not fun. I mean, it's not so... It has to be true, but it's not necessarily easy. And this is where the bound of Deutschert, Seiringer, and Ingvason is very useful, because it allows you to use some kind of dominated convergence once you have a universal bound between the canonical and the grand canonical of the corresponding mu. Okay? So after the break, we will look at interacting systems, and I will try to explain to you a little bit the mean field limits. We took a lot of time on the non-interacting system, but I don't have any regret. I think it's useful. See you in so 5 minutes.
5 minutes.
5 minutes. Yeah, all right, so after this non-interacting long pause, let's go to interacting systems, perhaps. The mask, Harry. Merci. Perhaps it cannot hurt to tell you what we would like to prove, even if we have no clue on how to prove it. So problems for interacting systems. I'm not going to do a long review, but let's see if we agree on a theorem. I don't know. So we've seen that without interaction, there was this phase diagram with Bose-Einstein condensation and so on. So we expect that if interactions are kind of small, okay, then the same should happen. We have to decide what small means. But so if interactions are small or weak, or I don't know how to say, weak maybe is better, then there should be a regime where you also have a BEC. So now there are many different ways that interactions can be weak, and we can always look at all these ways and then decide which one is better physically, which is another question. But so there are usually two large class of models which have been studied, and it's the same as in a classical case, I guess. So the first one is a mean field. So the mean field regime, you just make the interaction weak by hand, in a sense. So you just put a small number in front of it, and then you fit this coupling constant to make sure that the interaction is weak, but still makes a role, I mean, appears in the results. So typically, that would be replacing W by something like W over N, okay, which would be mean field. Or, I mean, you could also think of working immediately with an infinite gas. So, you see, we have many limits. So, I talked about the thermodynamic limit, and now we want to do a kind of other limit where interactions are weak. Okay, so it depends whether you do both together or if you do first one, then the other one. Well, so if you already have done the thermodynamic limit, then this would correspond to replacing W by W over rho. Okay, so that would be a mean field limit. Okay, so a mean field is usually easier, though less relevant physically. Okay, I will explain. Actually, I will talk about mean field then. So I will tell you what is good and what is bad.
And question?
Yes.
Would you also make it long range?
So that's a good remark. So mean field is less relevant physically because you seem to be modifying the interaction yourself by, you know, tuning these parameters. And there are some cases where it's justified, in particular for long range potentials. Okay, so mean field has usually a better physical meaning for long range potentials. I don't know if it's what you wanted me to say. Or
you had the mean field with a finite box or so.
Yes.
But now you say you first take the thermodynamic limit. And you could also imagine maybe doing the mean field limit afterwards in a way of increasing the length scale of the potential. And maybe
you can do these Katz limits.
Was that what you have in?
No. Here I was just damping the potential by putting a small coefficient, if you like. Okay, the other limit is more physical. That's the dilute limit. So dilute is just that. Okay, so in the first case, you make interaction small just by putting a small coefficient. In the dilute limit, you make the interaction rare. It's not the same. Okay, so it's not that they are really small, it's that they are rare. Okay, so this is certainly more physical, and you can have a dilute limit just by taking rho to zero. Okay, so you make it so that particles interact only a little bit. Okay, so if you look at an infinite gas and you take rho to zero, if you take, for instance, a repulsive interaction, you expect to have BEC. However, this has not been proved, so I think one can expect that if we take rho small and W fixed, nice potential, then there must be a theorem, a bit of the same kind as the other theorem for the interacting system, or something similar, rho small but fixed. Okay. So what people could do, so nothing like that could be done. But what people could do, Manfred.
So you're now always in the canonical or something?
Yeah, because it's easier to formulate. Yes. So what people could do was to expand the energy at small rho, okay, and show that it has exactly the right expansion that you would expect if there is Bose-Einstein condensation. Okay, so this we don't know, but what we know is that the energy behaves as expected for small rho. And I'm always thinking of fixing the potential, right? So W is fixed. This fixes a length scale somehow. And then if you take this W fixed and you look at somehow the infinite gas do small rho, then the energy behaves exactly as if there was Bose-Einstein condensation and so on. There was a huge activity in the past 20 years, even a little bit more, on this problem with very famous results. They started, and this, they were mentioned by Serena, started with Dyson, who looked at hard spheres, and then there's a famous work by Lieb and Ingvason in 98, which was exactly deriving the first term in the energy, which is exactly the same as if there was Bose-Einstein condensation when rho goes to zero for an infinite gas. There was a similar result at positive temperature by Robert Seringer. Okay, that was all about the first order, and then a lot of activities about the next order, which is called the Li-Wang-Yang formula. okay, which is the next order in the energy, which has finally been proved this year or last year by Fournet and Solovay. Okay. So you see, studying just the energy and not the state is easier. Okay. And we will see that in a moment. Now, there are a lot of works about what's called the Gross-Pitayevsky scaling, which you've heard about yesterday. Limit. What is the Gross-Pitayevsky limit? Well, it depends how you confine your system, but philosophically speaking, what you're doing is you take rho to zero at the same time as you do the limit. Okay, so instead of doing first one limit and then the other limit, you do the two limits together at a certain scale, which is so that you can prove something. And in this limit, as well as in the dilute limit, you expect that the potential, so W, will essentially be replaced by 4 pi A delta, where A is the scattering length. So it's just that since you are in a very dilute limit, it's only interactions by pairs which matter, but so particles, they meet very rarely, but when they meet, then you remember the history of this meeting, and the history of this meeting is seen in this small depletion in the behavior of the particles, which is the scattering length. Okay, so this is a very complicated problem. Many people have worked on that. And still, I mean, BEC is still unknown. So what I would like, if you are interested in knowing more, I can recommend a review by Nicolas Rougerie, which he wrote recently in the IMS survey. Is it this year? You don't know, 21. Okay, where I think it's wrong to call it a review. For me, it's a lecture. Okay, so he explains very clearly all these limits, and he gives many different proofs, explains the proofs, the way you can prove it, with what kind of tools. So if you really want to know more, I strongly advise this reference. And of course, there's also the book by Seringer, Solovay, Liv, Invasan. What was the year? I forgot, but that's in this Oberwolfar. 2004. Okay, thank you. This Oberwolfar series. Okay, so I'm not going to tell you more. And actually, you've had several talks already. In particular, I mean, Serena did it very well at this conference. I would like to be much, much more basic and tell you for the last part about the mean field limit. Okay, so let me state some theorems and then we can discuss them, and then I think we will have to stop. Okay, so I will consider the following Hamiltonian, which is the sum of minus Laplace and xj plus v of xj, equal 1 to n plus lambda sum w of xj minus xk. So it's the exact same Hamiltonian as I had before, except that I am now damping, I mean, I'm putting a small constant in front of my potential. Okay? And as usual in mean field limits, so I will take lambda to zero at the same time as I take n to infinity. The natural question is, so if lambda goes to zero very fast, then I will be the free case. So how fast does lambda have to go such a way that I see something non-trivial? And it's, of course, lambda of order 1 over n. So that's the mean field limit. Okay, just because this is of order n, this is of order n squared a priori, if I just fix my, and so I dump it by 1 over n. So the goal will be to understand the behavior of this problem, and I will restrict myself to the ground state. Okay, so I will only look at the first eigenvalue of this h. Okay, and actually to make things very simple, I will just take 1 over n minus 1, you will see why this this specific choice. I mean, everything is going to be the same if I take any lambda which behaves like 1 over n, but that's easier to state. Okay, so the question is, I look at the ground state of my problem. What is happening when n gets large? So maybe I have to start with a warning. So you should really think that here we work at the macroscopic scale, right? I mean, okay, this is a macro scale, just because we will prove Bose-Einstein condensation at that scale. Okay, so if you start with the domain omega, okay, so here you have to think that my omega is fixed now. And this is why it's not so physical if you think about it, because at the macroscopic scale, you should not have W, because W is a microscopic quantity. Okay, so this is a macroscopic model, and normally I should not put W, you see? Let me explain this a little bit. So let me take the case where V is infinite outside of some domain. I mean, you know what I mean. So instead of putting a potential V, I will now restrict to a domain with Dirichlet exactly as we did. So if I take my Hamiltonian over the big L omega and I put my n particles in it, then I have the following Hamiltonian, which we've studied, except that now I have the interaction. And there's no lambda. Okay, so that's the model, the microscopic model in a big box. Yes?
Sorry, in these models you mentioned the long-range interaction. You said the mean field is justified, but is it also reasonable that then the W lives on the macro scale? Or is it sort of emergent that this...
Yes, yes. So if W is, for instance, Coulomb, which is long range, then by scaling, I can usually think of working in a box instead of having a V. Then I can usually, by working at the right scale, make it look like that.
There is no sort of screening length which is shorter than the macro length or in the quantum case.
I mean, there are many lengths, but anyway, let's not be... we will make the assumption that W has this form, and I'm now trying to explain to you that it's not very physical. And then I will tell you what we should do, and that's exactly Gross-Pitaevsky. So I want to explain a little bit what... Okay, yes?
A small question, maybe I missed something, but are you dealing with bosons or...
Bosons, yes. I'm not going to discuss fermions.
Okay.
So only bosons. There are similar results for fermions, but then you have to put a 1 over n to the 2 over d, which Marcello did yesterday. Anyway, so you agree that this is a very natural model for... microscopic model for such a gas. So now if I rescale this model and work in omega, what is happening? Well, you see, this gets an L square, and this gets an L here, right? So if I work at the macroscopic scale, that's somehow the model I should be considering. And I can do that. So you see that at the macroscopic scale, if W is really microscopic, then I should rather take it of that form. Which is complicated. However, you see that if I pick L to be N, if I make this choice N, L being N, then I can really write this as 1 over N, and then the sum of N cubed W of N xj minus xk, which now looks a little bit like a mean field limit, except that my W is rescaled at the same time as n goes to infinity, where this goes weakly to a delta. Okay, and that's the gross Pitayevsky scale. In 3D. Okay, so that's a more physical regime. Okay, where actually I have a 1 over n, but then I should rescale W. And if I want to make sure that this is really coming from my microscopic system, I have to take L to be n. And you see that the density goes to 0. It's like 1 over n squared. Okay, so that's the gross Pitayevsky limit, which people have studied. And we will not study that. We will study this simpler limit here. It's much simpler. However, I mean, you can always learn by developing some tools on simpler models. You can sometimes learn how to attack the more complicated models. So, let me now state the theorems in the mean field limit, which is much easier with, if you like, this very long-range potential. So we will want to prove a Bose-Einstein condensation. So let me compute the energy for a full Bose-Einstein condensate. Maybe I put the lambda back. This lambda will be, I mean, I told you what I will take, but let me put the lambda. Okay, so if you do this computation for a tensor state, it's not difficult. I mean, many integrals cancel. And what is it that you will find? You will find n times the integral of grad u squared plus v u squared, okay, plus lambda n minus 1 over 2, the double integral u of x squared u of y squared, w of x minus y, dx, dy. Or why n minus 1? That's because you have n minus 1 over 2 pairs. Okay, so there's an n minus 1 over 2. And then once you've chosen the pairs, like, I don't know, x1, x2, when you compute against your tensor product, you get this term. Okay, so you see why 1 over n minus 1 is nicer, right? Because now this is 1 for me, and then it's completely independent of n. But it wouldn't change anything if I take something which behaves like 1 over n. So this here is called the gross Pitayevsky energy, EGP of u, and I'm going to denote its ground state like that. So far, I have not given assumptions on V and W to make sure this is finite, but now I will write a theorem with assumptions, and both E of n and EGP will be finite, well-defined.
Sorry, Mathieu.
Yes.
Isn't it the Hartree function? Why do you call it
function? Ah, I like this. Yeah, yeah. Good, good, good. True, so people usually call gross Pitayevsky the NLS, I mean the one which has the u to the fourth. And Hartree, this one. But I changed my mind and decided that it's better like that, because when you open the old papers, is it Gross or Pitayevsky? I forgot Peter. Then actually they put a W.
But you are in the mean field, I mean.
It is a mean field, yes. I mean, you can call it Hartree if you like. I wouldn't mind. But I think historically there's no, I mean.
Okay.
So we actually call it Hartree in our papers, but then I decided maybe Gross-Pitayevsky is fine too. So let me call it Gross-Pitayevsky. So a theorem. So I told you that it's always simpler to prove that the energy behaves the way you think than proving the states behave the way you think. Okay? And we can actually prove the convergence of the energy under very, very large assumptions of the potential. So let me assume that the positive part of V is in L1 log. Okay. Positive part can do anything, I don't care. Of course, the negative part cannot do anything because I want to make sure everything is bounded from below. So let me assume that the negative part of V as well as W belong to LP plus L infinity, where P is equal to 1 in dimension 1, P bigger than 1 in dimension 2, P equal to D over 2 in dimension 3 and higher. Okay, and that's the best you can hope if you use Sobolev or things like that to just control and make sure everything is well defined. Then, E of N divided by N goes to EGP. Okay, so if I take a condensate, I compute the energy, I find EGP. I mean, I don't even know if there is a ground state, okay, under these assumptions. But I don't care. Maybe there's no ground state, but the ground state energy makes sense. There I wrote mean because the spectrum is always it's always closed. So I know it's attained, but it's not necessarily an eigenvalue. And the theorem says you get the same. I mean, the energy behaves like N times the Kospitaevsky ground state energy, so there is condensation, if you like. Okay? I don't think you can make it more you can make it more general by allowing V plus to be infinite outside of a set, if you like, okay, which you can do to treat this problem confined to a domain omega the same.
Yes. Why did you say that it is condensation? Just the
energy? No, I mean, it's not clear enough to tell you what's happening, but the energy is exactly the same as if... Okay? So that was theorem 3. Theorem 4. So theorem 4 is going to be the one you expect now. Except I need a little bit more assumptions on the potentials, though not so many. So this theorem is really in our 2014 paper. So let me take a psi n, which has the right energy, if you like. So psi n, hn, psi n is E of n plus little o of n. Okay, so let me take any guy. It doesn't have to be an eigenfunction or anything. Let me take any guy which gives the lowest possible energy up to a little o of n. And now I need assumptions, so I will consider two cases. So I will consider the confined case. So in the confined case, I will assume that V plus goes to infinity at infinity. Okay, so confined case. You could even take V plus infinite outside of a domain. Okay. So now it's confined. Okay. Then up to a subsequence. We have that the gamma k of psi n divided by n choose k converges actually strongly to what you think. U tensor K, dP of U. So I have to emphasize that we know it always converges weakly to something like that, but now I'm going to tell you this P is not anything, right? Where P concentrates on this M, right, which is the set of minimizers for EGP. Okay, so it says that there is condensation on the GP minimizers. So now there is Poisson-Einstein condensation, okay, with this kind of very long-range potential on the minimizers of this thing. But since I have not put any assumptions on V and W, really, these minimizers, they exist because it's confined, so they always exist. Okay, I cannot have any loss of compactness. However, they don't have to be unique. So the set of minimizers is not necessarily reduced to a point. So I know. So if it's not reduced to a point, then I can converge to any combination of these minimizers. And actually, you can actually construct psions that would converge to something like that for any p, any probability measure which concentrates on these minimizers. Okay. Okay. So it says what you would have expected, that there is Poisson-Einstein condensation in this mean field regime, and the condensate is a solution of this nonlinear equation, right? Because it's not a quadratic functional, it's quartic. So you get a nonlinear equation, which is this one. Okay, so it's a little bit like a Schrödinger equation, but with this potential W.
Are these minimizers isolated points, or do you know?
Oh, no, no, you could have a whole circle of, you could have symmetry breaking, in which case you could have a whole, I mean, can be a manifold, it can be, I mean.
And if you have a manifold, is it still a Poisson-Einstein condensation? Or?
Yeah, yeah. So you have to be careful. So here it's very vague in the sense that I look at any states which gives me the energy correct to the corresponding order. And then I tell you I can construct any average of those minimizers in the limit. A different question is, let's take the ground state. For bosons, the psion will actually be unique. What is it doing? So it will converge to some p, but which p? This I don't know, because that would require to be, more precise. Maybe look at the next order. So this, I'm not answering this question. What is the ground state doing? I don't know. Okay, but I know it concentrates. There will be condensation on the set of Gross-Pitayevsky minimizers, but I don't know which one for which p. Okay, even the ground state could behave differently up to subsequences, which will probably be the case if there is some symmetry breaking. So I don't know. Jacob,
why isn't the minimizer, so to say,
the solution of the Hartree equation of unique, what makes the non-uniqueness of the W. So if W has a positive Fourier transform, it's always going to be unique, because then that's a convex function of U squared. But if you take an attractive W, you could, then no reason.
Yeah, you have so general means.
Yeah, it is extremely general. I'm not assuming anything, you see, so.
Okay. Yes.
And do there exist examples where you have symmetry breaking?
Oh, I think yes. You can always cook up example with a V which has two. I mean, a W, sorry, or even a V with two L's, right? I mean.
There's a paper by Ashbacher, Polish, and co-worker. But you take two wells in an attractive interaction,
okay.
And then all the mass wants to be in one well.
Could you say again what kind of convergence is it?
Oh yeah,
yeah. So it's trace norm.
Okay.
So let me be more precise. You take the trace, you do minus, and this goes to zero. So there is very strong. That's because it's confined. You cannot have any particle escaping. So let me look at what I like to call the locally confined case, which maybe could be unconfined, but. So what is it? So now I will assume that V and W go to zero at infinity, both. Okay, so I'm taking the same assumptions. I'm assuming that V plus is in the same LP plus L infinity, and that they go to zero. So now far away the particles are completely free, but there might be some kind of well somewhere which maybe traps only a few of them. Or maybe there's no well at all, maybe it's completely translation invariant. V is zero, possible. Okay, then same result with weak limit, weak star limit in the trace class, okay, and M is not the set of minimizers, but that's the set of weak limits of minimizing sequences for EGP. Okay? So it's a little bit more complicated, right? So you look at the Gross-Pitayevsky problem. You look at all minimizing sequences, how they behave. Actually, using concentration compactness, you can describe really how they behave, but I'm just avoiding this here to make the statement simpler. Okay, so they could actually split, like you have n over 2 particles staying, n over 2 escaping, but maybe the n over 2 staying, they actually attract each other, and the n over 2, they also form a cluster. And then maybe you're unlucky and you're looking in the middle, then you just don't see anything. Okay, so depends where you're looking and so on and so forth. Anyway, so you look at all the possible weak limits, and then you will have the same result, weak star, and I mean, that's the best you can expect in such a general situation. Okay, so these are the three results, okay, which kind of solve the problems concerning Bose-Einstein condensation in this mean field regime under very, very large assumptions on the potentials. So I have to give you maybe more references. So theorem 3 was not stated like that in our paper. I think we did not put L1 lock. We had they were merged, the two, and therefore we only consider either confined or locally confined event for the energy, but there's no need to do that. And actually, using a proof which is due to Lévy Leblanc as well as Lieb and Yao. So they were considering special systems, actually gravitational systems, but they have an argument which actually one can generalize. One can prove theorem 3. And this I wrote in my ICMP 2015 proceedings. And you will also find it in the EMS survey of Nicolas. Okay, so I don't think this theorem has been published as such before this survey and proceedings. The proof is actually very easy. I mean, you don't need to know anything. I will try to sketch the first part if I have time. I have something like 15 minutes, right? So I have to decide what to do in these 15 minutes after we finishing discussing the theorems. So theorem 4, so it's really in our paper, our advances paper, but I have to tell you that the confined case, you can, I mean, so there were older papers by, I mean, so there were older papers. Now suddenly I can't remember the names because I'm getting tired. In this C-star algebras.
There's one by Kisling already.
There's one by Kisling, that's true. No, is it Werner? I mean, not Wendelin Werner, but another Werner. And I can't remember the names. Werber, yeah. Thank you. Werber, there were also Spohn actually did something, okay, where actually, so it was never really stated this way, but they were using some definite argument, and I mean, So our real contribution was more the case of lack of compactness, when you can lose particles. And this really requires a fine analysis, and actually you cannot just use definity. You have to look precisely what the particles are doing. In a sense, you want to use definity locally only when you're sure that you have a cluster of particles which converges. But you have to keep track of who is leaving, where they are going, just to make sure you don't leave, you don't miss any energy. So you have to do a kind of concentration compactness on n particles with n going to infinity and not losing anything. It was a little bit complicated. I would like to finish this lecture by doing a simple proof, which everybody should know, and I'm sure many actually already know it, of theorem 1. After all, I didn't do any proof, so. Proof of theorem 1, when W is positive type. There was this question, was it yesterday or the day before yesterday? Why is it important that W, that the Fourier transform is non-negative? Was it to Marcello? Or? Okay, I'm going to tell you why. I mean, somehow, it's not clear why repulsive is easier, and it's even less clear why Fourier transform. I mean, you see, the theorem is always valid, but the proof in this case is just a few lines, so let's do it in 10 minutes.
If you understand one, could you remind me, because there are... Which
one? No, three, oh, sorry. Okay, this one, I mean, convergence of the energy. Okay, so I'm just going to do this extremely simple proof just to relax a little bit before the end. I hope I manage to do it. Okay, so I'm going to assume that W has positive Fourier transform. I will try, and it's very well known in our community. I'm not sure it's so well known in other communities. I'm sure the trick is known, but let me anyway do it. Can't hurt. So I'm going to assume that W has a positive Fourier transform, and I'm also going to assume that this Fourier transform is in L1. And if it's not in L1, just an approximation argument will allow you to prove the theorem. But when W hat is in L1, I will get explicit bounds, easy bounds. Okay, so how does this go? Let me introduce the function rho of x, which is the density divided by n. Okay, so, or if you like, the marginal. Rho psi, okay. dx2, dxn. Okay, so it's the one particle correlation function divided by n, because now we work at the scale of the Bose-Einstein condensate, so now we divide by n. Okay. If you compute the gradient of rho, okay, well, I mean, let's assume everything is nice, so you get two real part, and then psi bar grad psi. I'm not writing the variables, just differentiate. Okay, now do a Cauchy-Schwarz. So you do Cauchy-Schwarz, so you get 2. And you see, when you do Cauchy-Schwarz in x2, xn, okay, there will be one term which will be rho again. Okay, so you get square root rho, and then you get square root of the gradient of psi squared. So that's the gradient in x1, okay, and dx2, dxn. Okay, just Cauchy-Schwarz. But let me note that the left-hand side is also 2 square root rho psi grad square root rho. Okay, so if I simplify, I deduce that I have proved the following pointwise bound, that the gradient square root rho psi is less than the integral of the grad x1 psi x squared. That's a pointwise bound. that was just Cauchy-Schwarz. This we usually call the Hoffmann-Ostenhof inequality. Because to our knowledge, they are the first who used it. But it's just Cauchy-Schwarz. Okay. Why did I do that? Well, I did that because if I look at the first part of my energy, okay, that's the first part of my Hamiltonian. This first part is n times the gradient of psi squared plus v psi squared, okay, where I do v of x1. And here I do the gradient in x1 by symmetry. And now you see that if I integrate my bound, I get that this is bigger than n, and then the gradient of square root rho plus v rho. So I get a lower bound. I should emphasize that this is an rd to the n, and here it's just an rd. Okay, so I've reduced an n-particle integral into a one-particle integral by Cauchy-Schwarz. And that's the beginning of the Gross-Pitayevsky energy. And I'm going to try to get E of square root rho. Okay, so that was step one, how to handle the first part is just Cauchy-Schwarz. So now let's handle the second part, so let's look at the sum W of xi minus xj. Oh, sorry, xj minus xk. Okay, and this applied to psi. So this we would like to get a lower bound. Okay. How do we do that? Well, we make the remark that if I integrate d mu of x d mu of y, w of x minus y against some measure mu, then this is a constant which depends on your definition of the Fourier transform, w hat of k dk, right? Because it's a convolution, so when I pass to Fourier, I get this, okay? And that's always non-negative, because that's my assumption that this guy has a sign. Okay, so this is where it comes about that W is positive definite. This allows me to control, to say that any integral of that form always is always non-negative. Good. So how am I going to use this? I will take mu to be the sum of the deltas at xj. Yeah, because then I will see exactly the W of xj minus xk when I expand, minus something, eta. Good. So what do I get? We are almost done. So I get the sum of W of xj minus xk, okay, which is bigger than. Okay, so I'm just expanding this whole thing, then I really get the double sum. So when I get the double sum, I will see the j equals k. So that will just give me minus w of 0 divided by 2, I think. Well, because I wrote j strictly less than k. And then I get the eta terms. So since I divided by 2, I just get the sum j equal 1 to n of w star eta of xj, and then plus a number, which is, minus 1 over 2, eta of x, eta of y, w of x minus y, okay? So using that w as a positive Fourier transform allows me to get this bound for any eta. Eta is anything. Now you will tell me, why did you do that? Oh, I think I messed up a sign, no? There would be an N in front here. Did I do some other mistake? I think it's okay. Why is that interesting? It's interesting because we have bounded from below a two-body term in terms of a one-body term. We had a double sum, and now we get a simple sum. What we pay is that we have this eta that we don't know, but we can always optimize over eta at the end. Okay? So now if I apply this to psi, I will see, well, minus nw of 0 over 2 plus the integral of rho psi w star eta. And then minus 1/2 eta w star eta. Okay, when I integrate against psi, this simple sum just gives me rho. Because now it's a one body. The n is because of the sum. Now what I can do is to optimize in eta. Now I can choose eta, and I choose eta depending on psi, in fact depending on rho, and since it's actually it's a scalar product because of this here, the optimal eta is n times rho. That's the optimal eta. So if I make this choice and I continue, I get minus n w of 0 over 2, okay, plus n squared double integral rho psi of x rho psi of y w of x minus y dx dy divided by 2. Very good. So that's almost what I wanted. Remember that we will multiply by lambda, this whole thing. Lambda is 1 over n minus 1. So here, 1 over n would be nicer, but we chose 1 over n minus 1. It's too late. So, but anyway, since this is non-negative, if I like, I can put an n minus 1 that's even smaller. So let me put nn minus 1 over 2. Okay, then it's a little bit nicer. And what have we proved? So when I multiply by lambda, I have shown the following bound that will finish the lecture. I have proved that E of psi is larger than N, the EGP of square root for psi, okay, minus N divided by 2, N minus 1, W of 0. So when I optimize over psi, I conclude that E of n is larger than E of n over n, okay, is larger than EGP minus W of 0 divided by 2 n minus 1. Okay. And of course, I forgot to say it, but E of n is always less than EGP because I can use as trial states tensor products. And so that's the bound. And that proves the limit, you see. And even it gives an error bound, which is like 1 over n, which turns out to be optimal. By Bogoliubov theory, we know the next order, it goes like 1 over n. So you see how useful it is when when the Fourier transform is non-negative, it allows to bound from below a two-body by a one-body without really losing much. So with this simple proof, I have to stop because it's time, and I would like to thank you for your attention.
We have time for some questions or comments or remarks.
No.
So you mentioned that you can compute the next order fraction?
Yes.
So in the mean field, in the classical mean field limit, the next order correction is not conservative. Is the case here?
What is conservative?
Stationary. Yeah.
Here it's stationary. Oh. So yes, I mean it would take us too far to discuss Bogoliubov, but when you have a unique ground state which is non-degenerate for this Gross-Pitaevsky energy, then you can go further and compute the next order in the expansion of V, which is of order 1, so when you divide by n, you get something of order 1 over n. So this bound is optimal. I mean, it has the right order, at least.
But then you see correlations. I guess the state is not...
Well, you see fluctuations more than...
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, the next order describes fluctuations around this condensate. That was explained a little bit by Serena, although it was the Gross-Pitaevsky limit, which is much, much more complicated. But the result looks the same here. But it's easier.
Maybe one can still say that there are like correlations, but they are very nice correlations, right? It's not...
Yeah, no, they are.
There are correlations, like the one described by Bogoliubov, but there are very nice correlations. They do not behave badly as this scattering function that I was describing yesterday. So, yeah, either fluctuation or correlation, in a sense, one can use the same,
Christoph?
from theorem 3 to theorem 4, you mentioned that there is a local to global argument where you need to make sure that...
No, it's just that theorem 4 has two parts, the confined case and the non-confined, only locally confined. So the confined case, you can write it as an exercise using Definity, because when it's confined, you know you will never lose anything, it's compact, and you will have strong convergence. Strong convergence will be enforced by the fact that it's confined. And then just applying Definity. I mean, it's really just a few lines. The first part of theorem 4, once you know Definity. Even the strong is enough. The second part of theorem 4, in such a generality, requires a fine study, the spirit of nonlinear analysis. You have to do concentration, compactness.
Remarks. Okay, then it's time to thank Mathieu.
Thank you.